So when things happen to us, you know, it's such a wonderful thing being a Christian to acknowledge, maybe we've forgotten a lot of the time, we take it for granted, but we acknowledge, hey, there's a wonderful God who's behind me, who's with me, who's all around me, who will never forsake me, never leave me, who I know he's never to doubt, who's always has provided, who's always been so good. I need to trust him. I must trust him. What other reasonable recourse is there for a human being? Really, a creature. When he thinks of the one who created him. So I detect a problem on the computer. I detect a problem in my own life personally. You do too sometimes. We can blame ourselves, and certainly a lot of the finger pointing may be it would seem to us, but you know what? There's always been this God. I delight that my sister has come to live with us for a little while, and my sister is also a product of a divided home. And my sister and I are full brother and sister. Wonderful is wonderful to be brother and sister in the Lord. And as we were children, our mom brought us through many things. Church people were great blessings to my sister and I and my mom. There was always signals. I didn't have a dad for many years after he left our home. I never saw him again for 20 years. A boy needs a dad. It's not the same without a dad. You know, I look back and I can see so many evidences of God's faithfulness in blessing my life and being in many ways a heavenly father in a unique and wonderful way to me, as I didn't have really a very good earthly father. In today's world, we have in our own room many in that same area of experience themselves. They have gone through those kind of upbringings. Maybe you're wrestling with temptation or a circumstance even now where you're perhaps, say, looking at a man, you're thinking of leaving your home, or you're thinking of disappearing, and you forget, may I say, the needs that your children have and your grandchildren, the blessing that is there. And yes, there is a God, and a Heavenly Father, and I'm thankful for that. But please reconsider in your temptation, your trial, and get things right with your God. But we are blessed as believers with one who is truly the greatest father imaginable. Can I say this? The greatest mother example also, the greatest mother. Almost arbitrarily, the reason, perhaps the maleness was emphasized that we have the Father who is in heaven, but in so many ways, ours is a very maternal, like Father. A glorious, wonderful Father who has loved us and cherished us and brought us through so many things. And we have felt unloved, but we have still been loved. We have hurt and thought nobody has known what he has known. There has been injury, there has been regret, there has been faithlessness on our part. But he has always been faithful, he has always been there. And my friends, as believers in Christ, he always will be and always will continue. By his workmanship, will continue until we enter into eternity. Lord may very soon come back and take his home to be with he himself. Some of us will certainly still die, this flesh will die, and will leave living brothers and sisters behind for a while. But when we take that big step, death or the rapture, we will be in the presence of God, and finally there we will not be still a product being worked upon. But in this life, this experience, what is God doing? He has ordained that we should be certain things. I think if there's any competition, well, there's of course no competition, but if there is any additional thought along this level, it would be the matter of charity. We think in 1 Corinthians chapter 13 of charity. In fact, faith, hope, and love, writes Paul. Why, what are these? Without charity. Without charity, which we translate more easily and familiarly as the word love. My friends, today this is our God and his care for us, and he is working in us. He has ordained that we be people of good works. He has no doubt ordained that his mate is our banner. Remember, his banner over me is love from the Old Testament. This is our God. And not only is there superintendency and plan and ordination by way of good works, by way of a life of love, but every facet of our life, I believe, he's in charge of. And we have, over the last 3 years, 4 years, looked at so many verses in that regard in this room together. Loving the Word, we have gone from verse to verse to verse, and we have seen the sovereignty of God, the bossiness of God, thank God, the plan of God, God being the superintendent. Hey, listen, what a difference it makes when we acknowledge Him to be so and rest in Him. I can't find a job. I'm a Christian. Listen, being a Christian and trusting in God is not reason not to be out there looking for a job. But when we're doing so sincerely and with responsibility under our God, isn't it nice to be conscious free and to know I can trust Him? He's still going to bless. You see, when we trust Him and rest in His providence and still live active, vigorous life in obedience to Him, we receive fruit. Praise God, fruit. An example of that would be Noah. You look in the New Testament, Old Testament, very early in the Old Testament, to the book of Genesis, chapter 7. We find Noah being spoken to by God. And in this one verse, God says to him, "Come thou and all thy house into the ark, for thee have I seen righteous before me in this generation." What a great verse. Do we know that God is a holy God? Of course we do. Is He a holy God in His desire for righteousness? Yes, of course He is. Is His desire, His plan, that believers be righteous before Him, cleansed by the blood of Christ, living righteously? Of course, we know that's His expectation. God says to Noah, "Come in. Come into the ark. You and all your family." See how the blessing in Noah's being righteous spread down to influence and bless the next generation, his children and their wives. And so a number entered into the ark. They themselves not righteous on their own for sure, but covered somehow by the righteousness of Noah. Noah enters into the ark, and God wants us to know this is indeed the straight truth. Thou and all thy house in the ark. Why? For thee, Noah, have I seen righteous before me in this generation. I know to the very explicit point that you're the only one, Noah. But the benefits are for you and for your children. And I beg my listeners this morning, as I must remind myself, that this responsibility and the trickle down from the living of our lives seeking to please God have benefit for the next generation. There's benefit as we are faithful and make our choices pleasing unto Him. But there's a hunger for the living of a life of charity and a life of good works and a life of holy living and righteousness. And the benefit is ours. Yes, it is ours. But it also trickles down to the next generation, to all those who know that. The greatest example of this in American history was a man named Jonathan Edwards, a man who I believe died before he was even 50 years of age. Jonathan Edwards lived in the 1700s in New England. He was a godly, disciplined man. And after he died, his accomplishments were studied. And at that time, there were a couple of families of Americans, very famous in a negative way, for producing a large number of insane, of the imprisoned, thieves, dependent upon society, unable to hold work. And these were studied and compared to Jonathan Edwards. And Jonathan Edwards' life was distinguished, even though it was short, 50 years or less, upon distinguished by the character of Jesus Christ influencing him. Same thing with our own lives. We have influence. And the blessing of God is ours as we seek to cooperate with his ordination, his desire for us to be people again of charity and of good works and of righteousness. And as we find his blessing, our own descendants and those around us are blessed also. I don't know about you, but the relationship with people, and I should not be this way. Maybe. I have a tendency to get away from people that appear to me to be living outrageously before God. Some people, they heard the warning yesterday, getting away from the buildings, the tall buildings, the towers of the city here, and you're going out in the country and there's thunder and lightning prophesied by these unfortunate types we call weathermen. And then, of course, the sky is blackening and we can hear all sorts of rumblings and such coming even our way. We can time them as to how far they are away from us. 1 second at a time. How far? How much time? Don't get under a tree! Don't get under a tree! And so, as we know, that lightning tends to strike things that are higher and avoid those that are lower. We take warnings, but then we look at things of other practical living and we insist that we can make better choices than God about associations and friends and business partners. You know, Christian, there are some jobs that are unworthy of a Christian. There may well be some unbelievers who are unworthy of real intimacy, true friendship with another who is a Christian. Jesus, hey listen, Jesus was and is God. We are not. We can handle less than he could handle. But there is reason for us to see indeed there needs to be some fitting discrimination. Because our God has a desire for righteousness, for good works, for charity in us. And blessing comes by our responsiveness, Noah saw it. And we experience that, we sense it. I have sensed during these latter years of my life in the Savior that there is a relationship between my proximity, oftentimes to sin, and my tendency or my openness to fall into it. Have you ever felt that way about yourself? The Bible speaks about fleeing youthful lusts. Get out of there. Get away from that. Do not allow it opportunity. David in the Psalm says, I hate the work of those who turn aside. It will not cling to me. It will not. It must not. And here is our wondrous God, loving us, sovereign. Our verse here, Ephesians 2, verse 10. We are his workmanship. We have been created in Christ Jesus under good works. By God has, even before time, ordained that we should walk in them. This is his purpose. And Christian, it must be our love.